Mr. Jessel, what advice would you give to a young comedian just starting?
Keep reading and keep trying, despite the fact that there's so little show business. If you've got it, you know, and if you've really got it, and I kind of have a feeling you have, unless you're going to be terribly unlucky, you'll get somewhere. Incidentally, Sam, give Larry a fresh cigar up there. He's eaten that one. He's got this bottle.
Well, I meant other than working, and not necessarily specifically for me, although it, thank you very much, although I did think about the question from that standpoint. What I meant was that you know basically the problems. There's an affinity that comedians have, that people who make other people laugh have, that no other group in the world have. Doctors might get together and they might understand.
That's exactly
but
right.
But not like comedians.
That's exactly right.
Another comedian can walk in and watch a man perform, and he sees the audience, and he can feel with his kishkes what the other man is going through.
That's right.
So what I meant was, I mean, that then
all comedians have the same kinship, I believe, as women in childbirth.
I think that's a beautiful way to put it.
I think it's true.
That's a beautiful way to put it.
Then my success as a public speaker, which is practically all I've done in the last 10 years or more, is the fact of the art of the budgeting of words. And the budgeting of words is done particularly by putting speeches on paper. Then you never say, if you have it on paper, you never tell the joke, and if it falls, then and I'm so glad to be here tonight. If it's there, you say it. And you can sum up things. This also comes from reading. I've just finished an album called The Legend of Eddie Cantor. And one line describes it, history on a phonograph record. And during this record, I want you to laugh, because since Eddie Cantor left no son, laughter was his cottage. And that's 11 words altogether.
Right.
And you just say it that quickly.
The friendship that you had with Cantor, would you say that you were closer to Cantor than you were to Burns and to Joel Stone?
Oh, yeah, closer to Cantor and his family. I was his only fully confidant. I had a memorial service up at Grossinger's last month, or this month, early in June.
May 31st.
May 31st. 1,500 people.
Did you do his eulogy? Cantor's
eulogy? He didn't have any. There were six people at his funeral. Three daughters, two grandchildren, his valet and myself, 7 people. He had no services. About a minute and a half. They said, the daughter said he didn't want anything. And it was all secretive. No one knew where he was even going to be buried but me and the family that were in California. But I think they were wrong. As I told him, I said, because he didn't belong to you. Only this which remains is yours to do with as you may. But he belonged to the world.
Right.
He was a very shrewd, great, the most resourceful comic figure, I guess, that there ever was in America. He was a businessman, lecturer. As I said, he was the first fellow of his size, from the standpoint of being a big artist, who looked away from the mirror in his dressing room quickly to see what was going on in the alley downstairs that led to the stage door.
Fantastic. I would say, and
he's the only guy who would come into a town and instead of saying, get the notice, he'd say, what can I do to help in this town? Now, of course, in order to do that, you have to be the authority of success and a lot of dough. But no one else ever did that but Eddie Cantor.
Interesting.